A very good afternoon. Welcome all of you. Today we will be taking up test number 12, okay, which is of political theory and the various, what is the meaning of it, okay, what are the various approaches to study and how there has been the evolution of political theory in a similar fashion of how political science as a discipline has evolved, okay. So, first let's understand political science. Okay, it is one of the most dynamic, right, and vibrant discipline. Okay, Aristotle considers it as master science, and he considers it as master science, but because it studies all aspects of our life, all right. So it is like a, it is also said that it is architectonic in character, means it is the foundation, okay, on which other social sciences have largely been built. Okay, now if we have to understand the evolution of political science as a discipline, right, so we will be looking at it in various stages. So the first stage, okay, in the ancient time, right, political science was largely studied as a branch of ethics or philosophy. Okay, so good life and good political life are inseparable, says Plato, right, and politics and ethics cannot be separated, right, and philosophy also, philosophy largely seeks to understand the basis of all things in our life, right, and thus it was, political science was largely considered equivalent to philosophy, okay, because it examined various concepts and ideals in that sense. Now, then in the second stage, okay, we largely see the influence of religion, okay, and how political science became, in fact, a sub-discipline of religious studies and not an independent discipline. Politics was not considered, there was no autonomy, okay, and how the church dictated all the institutions in the study. That's how church dominated the state, the king, everything. Is it fine? That's why in the medieval age, it becomes the sub-discipline of religious studies. Then we say the beginning of the modern era begins with Machiavelli, okay. That's why we say Machiavelli is a transitional thinker, right, because he is standing on the phase where there was medievalism and the modern age coming to an end, and he is the first person to separate religion and politics, separate religion and state, and establish the autonomy of politics as a discipline which should be studied in its own right, okay. And there should not be interference of church or religious studies in the way politics has to be pursued. Okay, so autonomy of politics as a discipline has largely been, okay, the contribution of Machiavelli. Is it clear? Right. Then in the fourth stage, after largely the Second World War, that the first time, okay, I mean, even though in the first, during the first war only, there was talk, there were ways of how that there should be some scientific, scientificism, okay, that scientific methodology that has to be introduced in the study of political science, right? But it is after the Second World War that it became more prominent, okay, and the contribution of David Easton has been great in this regard. Now, the need, okay, for bringing in behavioralism, okay, which is in the fourth stage of political science, is to bring scientific methodology, okay, and make political science more of a pure science, like the natural sciences. And what is one key feature of the natural sciences or study of natural sciences is observation, okay. So, behavioralism assumed like that how we can do observation, okay, of many other phenomena. Even human behavior can be observed, analyzed, and to an extent also predicted, okay. Now, but obviously this also came under crisis, and because of that, there was a huge crisis in the entire discipline of trying to, you know, mastering the techniques and methodology and bringing in sophistication, more procedural things, and losing the entire aim, okay, or losing the substance of why humanities or social sciences are studied. studied. Okay, so you cannot equate natural sciences and social sciences in the same manner. Okay, because it is studying about human life. And if it does not consider the context, if it does not consider, we cannot have, okay, a value neutral study of any human being. Okay, so whatever we study has to be in the light of the social, political, economic circumstances around us, and we have to take into consideration what can be the best way of doing the same things. And it is in this regard that rather than making political science as a pure science, okay, David Easton calls for post-behavioralism to incorporate the values, okay, right? Means bringing in more values, more ideas in the study of political science and study. And thus, it is said that post-behavioralism propounds that rather than pure science, okay, political science should be considered like an applied science and become a more vibrant discipline. It should be able to give more of, means not only facts, also take into consideration of realities around us. Is it clear? So, this is the evolution of political science. And this is how even political theory, okay, evolves in the whole from the ancient to the present times. So, if at all there is a question of the evolution of political theory, okay, it will be the same thing. How pol science as a subject evolves contributes in the study of how political theory is also evolving. So, kuch concept alag nahi hai. Wahi baatein hai, bas thoda sa mode karke us cheezon ko likhna hai. One is more disciplinary, one is how the discipline has evolved and how it has led to building up of theories with various times, okay. कोई कंफ्यूजन नहीं है, बेस इज द सेम. सो देयर इज, इट इज वेरी मच अ मैटर ऑफ डिबेट, ओके, इवन टुडे, राइट, वेदर पॉलिटिकल साइंस इज अ मोर फिलोसॉफिकल और साइंटिफिक इन नेचर. सो सम से यस इट इज मोर फिलोसॉफिकल, दोज हु से साइंटिफिक सेज दैट it is more about studying facts, everything can be observed, right, and we can study things like this. But if we say that political science, okay, is not like a natural science, it cannot be, it does not have scientific character, it has scientific methodology which can be introduced and it cannot be separated, okay, from the basic ideas or basic philosophical ideals, okay, that we study like justice, liberty, equality. So, they cannot be separated. So, we cannot treat political science as a natural science, okay. It is rather we would say that the discipline has more of scientific methodologies, okay, than being completely scientific in nature, okay. It has been evolved like that. Now, so what are the approaches of study of political science? Now, these approaches obviously are also the approaches of how political theory has evolved with time, okay. So, if the question again asks traditional approach of political theory or approaches to study of political science, it is the same thing. Answer ka base and substance is same, just the wordings will differ, okay. So, there are traditional approaches. And then there are modern approaches that we study. So, with the traditional approach, the first approach, okay, is the philosophical approach, right? So, what is a philosophical approach? What is philosophy? Okay, so it is the study of laws governing our whole life, okay? So, we study those basics, the basic grounds of why something exists, what is the reasoning behind it. And you know, it's like if we study in the works of Plato, right? So we say is Plato is philosophy, philosophy is Plato. So that's where beginning of the traditional approach to study events around us was there, okay. So the first approach or the how pol science began or political theory began was equated with the philosophical approach. Now the empirical approach is also as old as the philosophical approach only. Empirical approach is largely about study, okay, through observation, study through experience, okay, sense-based experiences, through comparative methods by observation. and it was employed by whom? The empirical method was employed by Aristotle and also Machiavelli. So along with saying that things have to be studied in a historical context, okay, Machiavelli also said that we have to observe at what is around us, okay, and that only then only we can actually guide the prince of what should be the right action that he or she he should pursue. So philosophical method approach, empirical approach. Now then there is the historical approach, okay, means studying events from the historical perspective and linking the evolution of political theory, okay, by going back to the past. Okay, now we know that all political theory cannot be philosophical and all philosophy is also not politics. Okay, similarly in the historical approach, all history is not political theory, all political theory is not history. So they have their independent existence also, and they also have some kind of an overlap where there is a strong interconnection. Okay, so history is the guide to the future. Okay, history is a the past is guide to future, guides the historical approach. Now in the present time, okay, historical approach has been studied from two ways. One is the textual approach, okay, so merely reading something and interpreting it in the way it is given, and one is the contextual approach. And contextual approach is we have to read between the lines, we have to read between the times and the age and the context in which the particular thinker is talking. So contextual approach is like we can say that when Locke says, okay, government is a trust, so at that point what was he meaning to say? If Machiavelli is talking about double morality or he is talking about aggrandizement, what was he meaning to say at that time? If you don't understand Renaissance, if you don't understand the conditions in Italy and you merely take his theory as given without analyzing the context in which he is talking, okay, what was his purpose, what was his objective, okay, until then your study, okay, will be incomplete. So in present time, historical approach is both textual as well as contextual. Now we can apply all of this in the present times also, okay, like the philosophical approach, how presently Rawls revived the philosophical approach, okay, and how he talks about how he emphasizes on values like human dignity. Also he emphasizes in during when he talks about justice, okay, as fairness. Then empirical approach also, how it has actually contributed to the study of comparative government and comparative politics. We can also apply the historical approach. For example, if today we have to study any particular relations, okay, between two countries, then we will move on to the past, okay, that guided that particular event, like the Kalapani dispute between India and Nepal. So we certainly study the historical approach, what was the British approach at that point of time towards colonies, how it shaped the treaty, okay, and then we analyze why this particular thing is emerging at this time. So yes, historical approach means history of events certainly guides us to enable to understand politics in a more better way, okay, like we had studied the trade wars, we studied how there is Thucydides trap, okay, all these phenomena that we understand in the present time, we always go back to how, you know, the wars used to occur between revisionist and status quoist power, okay. So yes, historical approach in terms of classical study means in terms of studying the older books, ideas, thinkers, and also how it actually enables us to analyze the evolution of institutions, like how parliament evolved in India and how it is presently there today, okay. So or how justice has been there in, or how argumentation has been passed of part of Indian society until ancient times, or you know, democratic decentralization has been there, okay, and how it has been there today. So yes, historical approach in present times always is also relevant. But it is not all of politics, because there are other dimensions. Then there is the legal institutional approach and legal constitutional approach. Okay, this is also a traditional approach of studying of political theory and politics, even though both do not mean the same. Okay, But yes, legal institutional approach is largely about institutions like the parliament, like legislature, okay? And we study how formally procedures take place, okay? Now, but it is not only about the formal procedures. Today we say that we also need to analyze the other aspects, okay, of beyond formal, how non-formal processes influence politics, okay? So yes, these are the traditional approach that are there, and they do have contemporary relevance. So a question can occur that traditional approaches of political theory or study of political science have lost their relevance. Then you say no. First you explain the theories also, and you also will explain their present importance or relevance. Now, when we are coming to the modern approaches, okay, so the most important is bringing in scientific character, all right? And if we have to look at who brought in the scientific character, okay, obviously it is David Easton, which is one of the most significant approach, okay, most significant modern approach. And even post-behavioralism is a very important modern approach. But two important divisions that can be drawn in the modern approach of studying politics or political theory are the liberal and the Marxist school of thoughts, okay? And in the liberal, we study about the elitist, okay, and the pluralist debates across different concepts, and how Marxists have contested this, what is the structure on which they have designed politics and the entire discipline, okay? That is also a very key contribution. So when you are talking of modern approaches, we are not only talking of behavioralism and post-behavioralism, okay? It is actually within the liberal and Marxist school of thought that things have also to be seen. So, what is the aim of behavioralism? Okay, the aim of behavioralism is to introduce scientific methodology. Okay, and why it is called a revolution? Okay, so it is called a revolution because it is not only bringing a change in the methodology of how the subject or discipline will be studied. Okay. It is bringing a change in the nature and scope of the discipline. It is actually bringing also a change in human life, in how politics will be organized, right? And that is why we say that it is a revolutionary approach, okay? Why? Because we will be bringing in methods, techniques, okay? How we will be able to regularly analyze the events around us, how there will be systematization, okay? So the techniques adopted by behavioralism will certainly bring in a change or transition in the way things have been studied, okay? Now, so why behavioralism? What is the reason for bringing in behavioralism? So what happened after the Second World War, okay, there were many movements that were occurring in USA, okay, and there were conferences also that had been organized, and political science as a discipline, okay, lost its relevance. And why is because political science focus had been largely in the study of the classics, okay? Means the thinkers prevalent at that particular point of time were analyzing earlier events and giving solutions as per, you know, the earlier classical traditions, okay? But they were not able to provide new theoretical understandings or underpinnings, okay, for the contemporary problems and the contemporary problems across the globe. And that is why it was very much needed that rather than having a very ideal or rather than having a very classical, historical, philosophical way of only analyzing the past, we also should bring in some scientific methodology, okay, some observation, bring in new contemporary theories to understand new contemporary phenomena, right? So we also see how Anna Arendt says, okay, that we have to bring in a new understanding of politics because there are so many events which are unprecedented in the 20th century, So the totalitarianism that emerged in 20th century has not been there in the past. So the analyzing things from the categories of the past will not actually provide us a right understanding. And that's why her, the way she interprets action, the way she interprets modernity, okay, how it has actually, you know, troubled us. And obviously she is influenced by earlier thinkers, but how she also provides independent theories. Okay, this shows the relevance of bringing new contemporary theories to contemporary problems that are being faced by states. And that's why we have behavioralism coming into picture. Okay. So obviously, if anything has come into being, there will be a way. Okay, it must be having certain characteristics on which that foundation is built. So even behavioralism has certain what? Okay, it has certain features. So very, very important. We will be analyzing. The first is regularities. Okay. What is this regularities? Means regularities means there is a pattern, okay, in human behavior, in events, in phenomena. We have to observe these regularities and then interpret and anticipate what will happen in the future. Okay, right? Second, systematization. Systematization means the right classification of data that is being collected. Okay. Means if we are talking about some hypothesis, okay, like I will give an hypothesis that religion has played a key role in Indian electorate, in the Indian elections. Okay, now if I analyze the data, systematization will show us that there is a link between the two. It has to be collected. My hypothesis is based on religion, so my data collection will also focus on these kind of religious factors. Okay, so this is known as systematization. Regularities means patterns that we are observing in human behavior on a continuous basis in political phenomena, right? Then with respect to verification, okay, now how I will do verification? Verification will obviously be through the facts that have been collected. If my hypothesis say religion has played an important role in elections, I will see whether my data collection matches, okay, this hypothesis in that I have propounded, and I will prove it, okay, by the method of this particular data that yes, religion has played. So verification happens through what? Verification happens through facts. Okay, then we are talking about techniques. So these techniques are what? What kind of techniques we will have to actually devise? So yes, since we are bringing in scientific character, so we bring in statistical analysis and mathematical analysis by methodologies to understand the same. Okay, clear? Then we have to talk about measurements. So when we are talking of measurements, whatever data collection we are doing, okay, it will always be more than any abstract idea or hypothesis and verification of their hypothesis. Okay, it will be based more on quantifiable manner. Means I am able to speak through numbers, like 14% of Muslims, okay, for example, in a particular state voted for BJP because of the problems that they were facing in that particular constituency. And in fact, Hindus had been troubled, so they had not voted. Something like that, okay. So measurements means anything which is more quantifiable in that sense. Now integration, okay. So integration has to be what, okay. Integration means I will not only be studying the one particular parameter. There will be social parameters, cultural parameters, scientific parameters, economic parameters, legal parameters, institutional parameters. So like establishing like an interdisciplinary character, okay, of studying a particular hypothesis or phenomena. And that's when we actually understand what all has played a role, okay, in that particular phenomena. So law, philosophy, everything. Value neutrality, okay, means I will not be guided by any particular values. I will be guided more and more by what? So value neutrality means there is, it does not mean that there is no consideration of values, but during the process, okay, of collection of data and all, my particular background, social background, economic, should not guide the study and research. That is value neutrality character. Okay, now then pure science that has to be established. Okay, and pure science is when we will observe all these methods, eventually, okay, political science will become a pure science like other sciences. So this have been the features of behavioralism. Now, what was the utility? How did it serve the purpose? So yes, it brought like empirical research in the way things had been studied. There was collection of huge data also, okay, and this data made a huge contribution in studying of comparative government and politics, okay. It also formed the basis for conceptual frameworks that had been devised, like system analysis, okay, like structural functional approach. So they all laid, okay, these conceptual frameworks that had been devised to study political systems, right, had been inspired and influenced by behavioralism. Is it clear? I'm doing a very crisp summary to just give you a very quick revision, but there are so many other aspects also and many other questions that will be arising, but we are taking it up in a most basic manner we can, so that you can largely have a broader picture, okay, of behavioralism. Now let's come to the criticism of behavioralism. So bringing in only scientific methodology without consideration of values, okay, is never sufficient for the study of political theory, okay. So what is this? It is first criticism that this is mindless empiricism, okay, means you are only focusing more on technique, observation, facts. But what is that the society ought to do? Okay, that particular thing has not been under consideration. Narrow inductive view has been there, okay, because of the scientific inquiry that has been brought on the basis of certain few generalizations that we are seeking to do. Okay, so just looking at particular facts and events, we are doing a larger, generalization is not very fair. Then it stresses, okay, behavioralism stresses more on what can be measured than the theoretical significance of that particular thing, okay. So we should have focused on whether it can contribute, but we are only looking at observable facts, okay, what can be quantifiably done, but not whether it actually holds importance in the study of political theory, okay. It concentrates on overt than covert phenomena, means only those phenomena which could be observed. But there is something which cannot be observed, okay, which has to be interpreted, okay. So rather than this interpretation, we were only going for what we could see. This under analysis, okay, this reading between lines was not there. So mindless focus on techniques has been there, sophistication of methodologies has been there, but we have somewhere, okay, lost the substance, okay, or substantive character, okay, of political science. Now, so comes into demand post behavioralism, okay, since 1960s. So it was criticized that scholars are sitting in ivory towers mastering their techniques, okay, and all these theories had largely been like armchair theories and not actually leading to any kind of conclusion, okay. So David Easton incorporates deep within the importance of value, okay, value preferences in the study of events and phenomena. So he talks of the credo of relevance, and he says that there is need for a creative theory, okay, and this creative theory should be guided by both action as well as relevance. right? So he gives this call for post-behavioralism. Now, when we say that, is post-behavioralism contradicting behavioralism? No. It is, in fact, building on the missing aspects of behavioralism. Okay, it is like a synthesis that we are trying to adopt. So, it is not in complete contradiction. It is actually improving the limitations that we have found in behavioralism. All right? Now, let's see what have been the features, okay, of post-behavioralism. So, why we are studying something, okay, the aim of studying a particular phenomena is more important than the technique employed in studying that phenomena. Why we are studying social movements? Why we are studying electoral behavior in Europe and in America and in India? And what commonality in the pattern are we observing? Okay, what is it? Why we are saying? So, the underlying analysis is the rise of rightist governments. So, why, how this rightist governments has implications on the world, right? So, aim of studying is, what is the essence of studying that is more important than how it has to be studied of anything. Because this aim actually seeks to ensure, it is related very much to how life can be more better. Okay, for people, how there can be better emancipation, how there can be amelioration of conditions of the masses, okay, how it can be improved, okay. And this has been the aim of the discipline also. Is it clear? Then, task of social scientist is obviously more challenging than natural scientist. So, by merely studying some observable facts, we cannot say that, you know, this phenomena is completely explained. How a particular event should be, what should have guided society or what should have guided government in the, you know, time, okay, or in the present or in the future. That factor also should have been analyzed. So, social scientists will have to not only look at some facts and give a conclusion, okay, they will have to look at which are the actors involved, what are the stakes in that particular event or phenomena of the different actors, plurality of actors, institutions, okay, these things. So, yes, and this is a difficult task and you have to fulfill it, okay, if you are a political theorist. Then, value-based study is very, very important. We know what is the present situation, but if we always think of what is, will we ever move to what ought to be or trying to go towards more progress, okay, in terms of multiple progress, social progress, ho, cultural progress, ho, economic progress, ho, political progress. Ho. If I always think that, you know, sati is justified because it has been prevalent since times, okay, ancient times till now, and it's okay, then will I ever think that what is the impact of sati as a particular phenomena in the future to come? Actually, sati should not have been there. Why? Because it is against justice. It is like a form of discrimination. It is injustice to the women. If I don't think of the ideal, and if I don't think of what ought to be, then I am actually compromising, you know, happiness. Then theories should be devised in such a manner, okay, that they are able to solve the crisis, okay. Like if Rawls is propounding the theory of justice as fairness, he is guiding us that what can be done in liberal democratic societies. If Amartya Sen is telling us that we need to have equality of capabilities rather than only bring in actually equality of welfare or resources, until he gives this kind of developmental approach, will this capability approach be incorporated in the policy of the government when it is actually considering the education sector or when it is considering the health sector? So, ye jo contemporary theories hain, okay, inka ek relevance hai. And the crisis, the prevalent discrimination, prevalent inequalities in society that are existing, okay, it should be able to give some guiding light in that regard. That is the idea of post-behavioralism. Then, okay, promote values okay, actually leading to flourishing of human, such values which flourishes human civilization, right? And not leads to more degradation, more regression in that way. Political science should be viewed more as an applied science than pure science. Sirf methodology laake, mindlessly, techniques achhi laake, analysis kar diya. Par agar humne society mein aisa message nahi choda, ki if this crisis can be resolved in this particular manner, then what have we done? We have not actually solved the problem, okay? We have just given a study without looking or without giving a vision, okay, to the government of the day or to the prevalent crisis, and thus the discipline will lose its relevance. Then political science should be established as a useful discipline. So theories, contemporary theories become important in that sense, because we are saying that theory should solve contemporary problems. And that is why if we see, even UPSC presently is asking so much of contemporary scholars, okay, because somewhere these contemporary scholars talk of the prevalent problems in society today, okay, be it terrorism, be it globalization, be it health pandemics, okay, injustices, hunger, poverty, all of them are relating to these events that are existing across the globe, right? They are talking of how, you know, governments can approach these particular things. What kind of rights should be there? What kind of equality should be there? What kind of justice should be there? What kind of institutions should be there? That's how, you know, pol science will become more sensible, more applied. Okay? So, this is a brief view of how we look at the traditional approach, how we see the evolution of the discipline. So, largely covered all the contents here, okay, that we have pointed. The disciplinary evolution of pol science, okay, nature of the discipline, then utility of the subject, approaches, modern and traditional and modern, behavioralism, what is its critique and what is the post-behavioralism, why it was introduced, and what is the, has it really been able to serve the purpose it was designed for? Now, let's come to the question, okay? I have given a very comprehensive answer, but you have to tweak it to the 20 marks, because actually students are very weak in this particular chapter and unit. They are not able to have a clarity. Agar ek word theory ke jagah science aa jata hai na, political science, to confused ho jayenge. अरे जैसे जैसे सब्जेक्ट बढ़ेगा उसकी थियोरी भी तो वैसे इवॉल्व हो रही है, इसमें क्या अलग बातें हैं, एक ही बात है, वर्ड्स अलग है. सो लेट्स सी नाउ, एग्जामिन द सिग्निफिकेंस ऑफ बिहेवियरल रेवोल्यूशन इन पॉलिटिक्स. सो वी हैव स्टडीड व्हाट इज द कंट्रीब्यूशन मेड ऑफ बाय द बिहेवियरल रेवोल्यूशन. What were its limitations? So, criticism bhi dalna hai. Okay. To what extent post-behavioralism corrects these limitations? So, post-behavioralism ke characteristics or how it aims to correct the problems that are there in behavior. Okay. Ab ye pura question, jaise humne dekha, majority of you did mistake. Behavioralism se shuru kar diya. पोस्ट बिहेवियरल बिहेवियरलिज्म में लिंक क्या है, कहाँ से उठा है सवाल? पॉलिटिकल थियोरी से सवाल उठा है. दोनों चीजें क्या करना चाहती हैं, पॉलिटिकल थियोरी की स्टडी को, ओके, हाउ हम चीजों को पढ़ रहे हैं, ओके, हाउ पॉलिटिकल थियोरी हैज बीन, यू नो, व्हाट हैज बीन द एम ऑफ पॉलिटिकल थियोरी, उन दोनों में ये एक कॉमन लिंक है. तो शुरू उससे करना चाहिए था, राइट? बट मैनी हैव डन रॉन्ग वे. So, the first idea, okay, that you should have written is about the objective of political theory. Right? So, the behavioral revolution. Okay. Political theory is not fantasy or paradigm of prejudices. Okay. Nor an intellectual game. Okay. Argues John Plemnitz. Political theory must analyze perpetual problems confronting man and his existence in society. अब ये जो एसेंस है, ओके, दिस कैन बी यूज्ड इन एनी क्वेश्चन विच इज वेरी ब्रॉड, ओके, एंड पर्टेनिंग टू पॉलिटिकल थ्योरी. दिस इंट्रोडक्शन यू कैन यूज कॉमनली. ये सब क्यों पढ़ा जा रहा है? पॉल साइंस क्यों पढ़ रहे हैं? सोशियोलॉजी क्यों पढ़ रहे हैं? लॉ क्यों पढ़ रहे हैं? क्या जरूरत है हमें ये सब पढ़ने की? साइकोलॉजी, व्हाई आर वी स्टडिंग सोशल साइंसेस? बिकॉज योर एंड माय लाइफ, योर एंड माय एग्जिस्टेंस इन सोसाइटी has to improve. Leveling conditions have to be there. That I can live a good life and you can live a good life. Okay? That is the thorough objective of political theory. Right? Now, then we talk of how behavioral revolution, what it brought in political theory. So, it in politics was the advent of a modern political methodology. Okay? As a revolution. So, this is the significance because it was revolutionary in character. Okay. Compensate for the perceived deficiencies of traditional approaches. अब इसको सिर्फ behavioral revolution को हमने ऐसे नहीं देखना है कि सिर्फ scientific character है. नहीं, traditional approach of study of politics जैसे philosophical, historical, legal, empirical, okay, legal institution, इन methods को पढ़ने में ना कुछ दिक्कतें थी. तो इसकी वजह से we could not explain every phenomena. That's why we brought. तो डिसिप्लिनरी कैरेक्टर से भी एक्सप्लेन करना है और द प्रेजेंट प्रॉब्लमैटिक ह्यूमन लाइफ के कॉन्टेक्स्ट में भी एक्सप्लेन करना है. राइट. इंक्लूडेड साइंटिफिक रिसर्च मेथड्स फॉर पॉलिटिकल एनालिसिस एंड एम्ड टू साइंटिसाइज द डिसिप्लिन इनटू. सो दिस इज द की ऑब्जेक्टिव. ओके. सो फर्स्ट वी रोट अ व्हाट इज द ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ पॉलिटिकल थियरी, हाउ बिहेवियरल रेवोल्यूशन प्लेड अ की सिग्निफिकेंस. देन okay, the significance was that it emerged at the time of crisis in politics and decline of political theory. Okay, traditional approaches were accused of being divorced from reality and propounding armchair theories while sitting in ivory towers. Okay, as told by whom? By Easton. So many historical methodologists of ignoring psychological, social and economic factors. Okay, economic factors, that's why we bring in statistical and mathematical ways of doing things in behavioralism. Then we talk of Chicago school, okay, highlighted its significance also, right? Then we talk of, after talking of significance, what are the basis of behavioral approach. Now you need not necessarily explain everything, okay, though I have you can just draw the circle and put out the 8 intellectual foundation stones and examiner will understand. Is it clear? I have explained this so that you understand why this every intellectual foundation stone has done what. What is the key role of it, okay? But we know that it was not foolproof and scientific methods could obviously, right, not cover vast areas in politics because every area cannot be quantifiable, right? Then we are criticizing behavioralism, okay, because actually behavioralism is given by liberal scholars and we know liberal approach and Marxist approach are two important modern approaches of studying politics, okay, and they have made a key contribution to the study of political theory. So, since behavioralism is criticized as a status quoist in nature by the Marxist, okay, or because it doesn't, it is more closer to the liberal way of working, right? Then we give the Marxist criticism of behavioralism, right? Then we talk of how David Easton brought post-behavioralism and why he brought it, okay? Because he was talking of certain shortcomings in behavioralism. Give those shortcomings. I have given them in detail. Just tweak the words. Okay. Itta comprehensive nahi likhna hai, but just because I wanted you to have a fair understanding of this entire unit, I have given it. Then talk of how he talks of credo of relevance, okay, and then largely explain okay what are the features of post behavioralism and how it is like a synthesis, okay, how it seeks to synthesize the traditional methods also and the behavioralism and its scientific methodology. Okay, so that's how you should have ended. Now the next question is, political theory can seek truth, okay, alongside the scientific empirical methods. Now, what does this truth here mean? So, we know that truth is always a very much relative concept, okay, but truth is always guided by right or wrong. And right and wrong is part of ethics. Okay. So, political theory can seek normative basis, because philosophy, ethics is part of normative study, right? With scientific empirical. Now, this whole question, what everybody, matlab majority of you have interpreted, is seek truth alongside the scientific empirical method. So, sabne emphasis on behavioralism de diya hai. But we had to show how there is integration of normative or traditional way of looking at things, okay, and how also the scientific character has been brought in the study of political theory. So, this is one mistake that you all have done. So, political theory is systematic knowledge first explain of any political phenomena. Sabayan says, political theory is anything about politics or relevant to politics. It is the science and philosophy of what is political. So, first you should have explained the meaning of political theory. Right. Next. So, when we are talking that it can seek truth, means normative philosophy. So, we are, and scientific, which largely comes in the later era, okay. Even though empirical approach was there, but more emphasis on scientific has come in with advent of behavioralism. So, you talk of how behavioralism, I mean, political theory has passed through different stages, okay. So, first is the classical political theory in ancient Greece and how it was equated with philosophy, right? Comparative studies also. Then how modern political theory, okay? What are the approaches of studying of modern political theory you should have emphasized? Then you should have spoken about what the contemporary political theory aims to do. Okay, with conceptual investigation of all the events that are happening around us, okay, which should be done in the context that is given today. And then we talk about how, okay, that political theory can also emphasize on the traditional way, traditional methods are also relevant, and the scientific methods are also relevant, because eventually political theory is actually seeking to what, do what? You know, provide solution for good existence of man and his life, okay. So, it has to bring in the value-based methods, the historical methods, the philosophical methods, and also the scientific character, because the scientific character largely will take in consideration other factors also like economics, psychology, law, okay. So this way, the interpretation has largely been of how traditional methods and modern approach both contribute to political theory. Is it clear? So this is about today's class. I have largely given you a broader picture, okay, but there are a lot of details that you should be studying when you study this chapter, because the questions of this chapter are very difficult for students to interpret. स्टेटमेंट समझ में नहीं आता कि इसमें अप्रोच लिखनी है, इसका एम्फेसिस बिहेवियरिज्म में का ज़्यादा करना है या पोस्ट बिहेवियरिज्म का ज़्यादा करना है या नेचर ऑफ डिसिप्लिन के बारे में लिखना है. सो हैव क्लैरिटी विद दिस काइंड ऑफ द इंटरप्रिटेशन ऑफ क्वेश्चन इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. इट कम्स इन 10 मार्क्स ऑल्सो, इट कम्स इन 20 मार्क्स ऑल्सो. बी प्रिपेयर्ड फॉर द होल सम आइडिया. ओके, सो थैंक यू वेरी मच. वी विल बी टेकिंग अप द नेक्स्ट सेशन वेरी सून. All the very best. Thank you.